Zarsky Thibodeau, public access waiver. Just so you know, this is something that's going to be coming up, I believe, under other business. There's a memo I just prepared today and handed out to you now about this. But regarding the minutes themselves, what happened, there seemed to be some discrepancies from my memory. And what I did was I first went back at the planning board's request. I went back and listened to the planning board tape, or tried to. There was a mysterious, not quite an 18-minute gap, but there was a gap, and it turns out that that was the meeting where we were downstairs in the cafeteria, and that's where I first realized that the handheld tape recorder didn't make a loud noise when it turned off. And what I did later is I went and got a copy of the videotape, and sure enough, I could see at the right, just at the point where there seemed to be some confusion, there must have been probably a 4 or 5 minute gap, and poor Alice had to reconstruct as best she could, and she did a pretty good job.
Did we have it on videotape?
Yes.
We did have it on videotape.
Yeah, it was the handheld, not handheld, but it was the tripod video downstairs, which was broadcast later. The items where there were two items that I picked up that weren't reflected in the minutes. And I made the copy of the first 3 or 4 pages of those minutes for people to look at. It'd be on page 4, on the upper right-hand corner. Let's see, there were two abstentions. For those people that were there, the main issue seemed to come up, actually the major issue seemed to come up with respect to the first asterisk, which talked about sight distance. Mm-hmm. And this is an issue that's been discussed many times since the meeting on the 21st of August. But after watching the minutes, it turns out that actually it was Janet McKay that under that first asterisk that, let me go back. It states under the first asterisk that Mr. Tinsman requested the following addition to see above, and that the applicant shall obtain 350 feet of sight distance to the west. Then he talked about having the applicant communicate with the town planner and the town engineer to ascertain that, which was one item which isn't reflected there, and I'm not sure that's all that crucial. But after that, and after Mr. Emery's comment about having advanced engineering submit a plan, Janet McKay said that the board would want to have site distances to be adequate in both directions, and not just to the west. And so everybody seemed to nod and kind of incorporated that in. I mean, this was not a very formal sort of process in terms of making amendments and voting on each amendment. People seem to kind of go in and add them and have them added that way. So that was the one which I remembered, and actually I thought I was the one that brought it up, and turns out it was Janet McKay. So that's something that probably should be reflected somehow in those minutes. That was the major addition. Everything else seemed to be, the minutes otherwise seemed to correspond with what I saw on the videotape. It just turns out that portion of the taped, the audio taped portion was probably left blank during probably a three minute segment.
So the additions are what's underlined, or the additions are what's asterisked?
The additions would be what's asterisked, and asterisk indicates the sections that have some additions. Mm-hmm. The first asterisk, there are two underlines, two amendments, one by Mr. Tinsman, one by Mr. Emery. A third one should be added Ms. McKay, talking about the fact that the board would want site distances to be adequate in both directions.
So that should be added?
Yes. In addition, before that, maybe as an addition to Mr. Tinsman's amendment, it may be important to mention that he said that the applicant should be communicating with the town planner and the town engineer on this issue of site distance of 350 feet.
Since these changes affect Mr. Emery and Mr. Tinsman, Mr. McKay is not here, do you have is this a recollection that you can grab back out of your memory and
I wrote it.
Reasonable.
It's reasonable. Okay. Procedurally, how did we leave these minutes at our last meeting? Did we accept them, or did we ask for them to be notified?
They were not accepted. You asked the town planner to go back and listen to the tapes and come back with a report.
And I guess these minutes have to be now approved for the first time. They were not approved prior at our prior meeting. So I guess at this point in time, I would ask for a motion for approval of these minutes.
So moved.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Okay. Is there any further discussion? I guess we're going to get some discussion later on Zorsky, Thibodeau. Any more discussion on the issue of the minutes themselves? All those in favor? Opposed? Okay. For the remainder of the meeting, or until Mr. McKay arrives, Mr. Emery, would you agree to be a voting member? Just later on, and would you be kind of a stab at it, but for now, we'll go that way. Okay. Next item on our agenda is correspondence. Steve, can you go over some basic correspondence we should be concerned with here?
Okay. Correspondence actually, primarily deals with what's on the agenda. There was a fax letter or memo with comments from one of the town attorneys, Michael Hill, regarding the application completeness memo that I did. He just wrote some minor changes that need to be made. We also received a letter, in late September. September 26th. It was from the Cumberland County Soil and Water Conservation District, just updating the town on their review of the Highlands Broad Cove project. Thought it was might be interesting at this point just to have that there. It's more for information than anything else. The other correspondence was just, again, items regarding a topic that will be brought up under other business regarding the Zorsky-Thibodeau public access waiver. It's a letter from Bob Hunter, the town engineer at T.Y. Lynn, to myself, Steve Butler, town planner, regarding some of the actions that the board asked both of us to do.
That's prior correspondence. Haven't we received that letter?
I think only you did as chairman, so I'm listening to have it. We also received today just a brief memo from me regarding, again, that other the same issue, Zorsky-Thibodeau. And I believe that's it in terms of other.
Okay. First item on our agenda, no questions on correspondence. First item on the agenda is a public hearing under section 19-2-9 of our ordinances, and this concerns the Viking Intermediate Care Facility, construction of a 60-bed addition at 126 Scott Dyer Road. As I open this hearing, do we have a representative of the Viking present?
Yes, one of the co-owners, Ronald Butat.
Ronald Butat, thank you. All of us except myself, I guess, have taken the sidewalk. I got over there later on this evening and took a look at the addition and the stakes that you had going on, so I've had a chance to at least glance at it. It may be worthwhile taking a very short 2 to 3 minute run through, if you can, of what you plan on doing and some of the key issues involved.
Okay. Approximately 11 years ago, we came to the Cables and Planning Board with the attitude of building a 60-bed facility on the land on Scott Dyer Road. At that time, we had attitudes of expansion, and as 11 years have gone by, we've recognized that those attitudes of expansion have greatly changed by the market needs and by the demands of the elderly population. Approximately 7 years ago, we came to the town with an attitude after purchasing some land of building a congregate facility, and at that time, it looked to be that the real need of the elderly were more in apartment-type settings than it was necessarily assisted a daycare of the things that we're seeing today. At that time, working with the Planning Board and working with the Zoning Board of Appeals in town, there was a storm moratorium that Cape Elizabeth was dealing with, and we basically shelved all plans at that time until such time that we felt that we could move ahead with future expansion once sewer permits were available. Well, that came about approximately a year and a half ago, and then looking at the true feasibility of taking care of people on our grounds and the settings that we could offer and the types of care that we could offer, we recognized the congregate facilities, not only because the zoning ordinances had changed, but we just felt that that was not what we should be offering at the Viking Hill Nursing Home. And the reason for it are manyfold, but mainly what we've seen, because of cutting of federal funds, cutting of building of new nursing home beds, we've seen escalation of cost in nursing homes in the last 10 years from approximately $70 a day for a private patient to $140 a day. We've also seen that in a mixed level of care in nursing homes, you run on a level of care of level 1, 2, and 3, 1 being the lightest care, and what we call the assisted care type things, needing personal hygiene care, meals, things of that type, making sure they can get out of bed in the morning, to those levels of care where we have people that are bedridden, who have to be helped up every day, have to be fed, and have to have medication. We found that what was a pretty much even mix in 1979 has come about to be a problem, approximately about a 60% mix of the higher levels of care. Of course, what that has demanded on the state level, and that's happened across the state, what that's demanded is adding many more personnel to take care of that facility and take care of those people, of course, escalating the cost. One of the things that we've noticed is the fact that that level one care, that person that in fact could be taken care of on a daycare basis, who can then sometimes be taken care of home patient care, that person was really not being taken care of because the system just didn't allow it anymore from lack of beds. And then crept in the word to take care of level one care, assisted. And what is assisted? Assisted, as we look at it, is that level one care that says that a person starting off with short-term need might be living at home 80, 85 years or older, might be living at home with a spouse or a young or with a working child, and might fall and break a leg. That person necessarily does not need to be maintained in a nursing home, nor that type of facility for the long term, but basically needs some help. Home care in that circumstance becomes very expensive with private nurses' care, and there is a definite need, and that need we find can be responded to in assisted care facility, mainly because the day cost of assisted care runs approximately $75 a day instead of running $130 or $140. So as we looked at the true need of the aging population of what we're going to see here in Cape Elizabeth as well as across the state, we recognize that 39% of the population right now in the state of Maine over 85 needs some assisted care. Not necessarily true nursing home care, but assisted care. We also notice that in the next 10 years, the population in the state of Maine in retirement people over 85 is going to grow approximately 25,000 people. We'll be taking care of approximately 2 for every 1 person in the assisted care side that we're needed today will be taken care of in that amount of years. As we all recognize that there just were no funds, no state funds, needless to say, and also with all the budget cuts, needless to say, no federal funds, for those frail elderly that are not necessarily in need of that continued nursing care. So we came with our concept, which is a growing concept across the United States now, of taking care of the level one on an assisted basis, providing those services such as nursing, such as doctor care, if needed, on a contracted basis, but yet being able to take care of the personal hygiene care, so that person that's alone or that person that needs that short-term care, in a healthy surrounding of a nursing care facility that makes those people able to rehabilitate themselves back into the society, and yet have a feeling of a semblance of some comfort while they're recovering. Also, that person that is alone, that's lost, that doesn't have children, and there are a lot of those who have lost a spouse, that basically wants a neighborhood environment, who wants to still within reason have contact with the community, but again, does not want to have to move into an area where they do not have that security blanket called the button that can call someone if they need them. So that basically is the type of care that we're adding on to the Viking Nursing Home, which is, if we looked in 10 years ago, would have been that level one care. I only, for one second longer, can say that I can remember, and by the way, Dwayne did call tonight, he apologizes, and I don't know if I should say this, but he's at a convention, and it bothers me that the national convention this year is in Hawaii, and he says it's very nice, and I don't know if he's working, but he asked me to come here and explain nursing home care, and I said, gee, Dwayne, you're lucky, you're in Hawaii, but he said hello. One of the things that he wanted to mention was something that I remember, that there's a very great need in nursing homes today to maintain those people who are at a level three, who cannot get out, to give them the spontaneity of other people helping around them. Because of what we've seen at the Viking, we are seeing that person not there anymore. When you went to the nursing home at the Viking 10 years ago, one of those level one care people would be delivering mail, would be going in and being part of that community activity in that nursing home. Very sadly, that is not the case today, mainly because of the levels of care that are needed and the amount of beds that go around. We feel that that assisted care facility, because it is only rigged to take care of that level of care, will open up that feeling again that we felt we tried to maintain, but is very hard in that medical situation. We have hopefully answered all of the questions of planning and all of the questions of need and all of the questions of our good neighbor policy as far as our being part of Cape Elizabeth, and hopefully as much as we've enjoyed Cape Elizabeth, we hope that they've enjoyed us, and we feel that we're here for a long time. I like to think that I'm 51 years old, and that's young. Dwayne likes to tell me he's 6 years younger than I am, and we need this to say in our world of economy, we have to keep working and making a living, and we like making a living in Cape Elizabeth. And hopefully with this facility can only add to what will be good for the town, but also make it more financially feasible to run a good nursing home.
Thank you, sir. Now, this is a public hearing. At this time, we'd like to invite comments from the public. If you do have comments on this application, I would appreciate if you would come up to the microphone and identify yourself. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I'm Pat Haynes, resident of Cape Elizabeth.
Mm-hmm.
As I understand it, a sidewalk will be extended from the facility?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I just want to encourage that and express appreciation that that's happening in this case. I think that'll help integrate the facility more with the neighborhood and certainly benefit people along Scott Dyer Road. On another matter, I would encourage the planning board to do whatever is needed to alter the town charter or ordinances in such fashion that will permit requirements of that nature for future developments. As I understand it, talking with Stephen Butler today, that's not the case in Cape Elizabeth. However, in checking with town planners in Saco, Portland, and neighboring communities, they have that capability. So I encourage the board, if you see it as something reasonable, to work in that direction. I think another matter, as far as correspondence, you might want to consider including telephoned correspondence in your future meetings, or if you choose not to, to at least publicize that people should be using fax machines in order for their input to be so recorded. Thanks very much. That's all I have.
Thank you. Just as a point of information, we have had an infrastructure subcommittee on the planning board working through the summer. And some of the issues that were sent to the town council, the planning board can't really make ordinance modifications. We can make recommendations to the town council. We're not empowered to make any changes, though. We did recommend some changes to support infrastructure development in the town.
Great.
So something may be coming back to us through the ordinance committee of the town council on these issues. So something has been considered in that area.
Great. That's good to hear.
Good.
Thank you.
On the subject of the sidewalk, is it worthwhile for the board just to trace where that is going again? Is there a question on where that's located?
Steve Woods, I'm going to get back to it. I think that the board could show that. One of the things I didn't mention that I think is very important is the fact that Ken Coffin, our project director, has worked at a great deal of time with great appreciation from us to the city conservatory land trust.
and we have arranged for deedings of all of the out parcels surrounding the nursing home to be part of the land trust to keep that land forever open and used to the Cape Elizabeth community, and needless to say, as well as the people of Lincoln.
The sidewalk's going to stretch out in front of the Viking nursing home, and it's going to run down as far as the entrance into where First Atlantic
okay. is proposing. That's what I thought it was. I guess that's clear to everybody who was on the sidewalk, even though it was raining, right? Okay. All right, thank you. Any other comments from the public? Hearing none, I'll close the formal public hearing section and open the questions to the planning board. If there are any questions, comments, or reactions to the sidewalk, this might be the time to bring them up.
Mr. Chairman, just a couple of comments and a couple of questions that were raised on the sidewalk, and both pertain to the left-hand side of the chart that is shown, or the upper entrance to the Viking nursing home. One of the issues that was raised and a question that developed was an issue that the applicant had previously brought up, and that was the removal of two large trees at the entrance of that upper entrance. And during the sidewalk, we had talked about the need for determining how best to ensure that sight distances were maintained as cars exited from that entrance exit. And I'd ask the applicant to indicate to us what they have been able to do in the last few days, and there hasn't been much time since the sidewalk.
We have arranged with the engineer to do the traffic study for First Atlantic, in which we are incorporating into our plan, to meet with us tomorrow, and he's meeting with us at 2 o'clock tomorrow afternoon at the Viking to ascertain, as you people suggested, the true sight distances, have him mark them out, a stop sign, and what we could do if in fact we could maintain those trees and provide the proper sight distances. And he is meeting with us tomorrow, and hopefully we'll have that submitted to you for your November 2nd deadline.
Good. One of the issues that was raised by one of the Conservation Commission members who were in attendance with us on the sidewalk was the possible removal of an obstruction, visual obstruction, which is a pole, and perhaps going underground from across the street.
We've also contacted Central Maine, and we're asking them to come out. And of course, it's their pole, and they're the ones that have to approve it, but usually they work very well, and I think tying that in with the site, you know, the site distances and this and the traffic control engineer, I think we probably can take care of it.
Okay. The other issue was the sidewalk as we were standing there looking up Scott Dyer Road toward the center of town, on where that was going to be in relation to the houses that were along Scott Dyer Road, how wide the sidewalk was going to be, and how wide the green buffered area would be adjacent to Scott Dyer Road. Maybe you could address that.
In driving in tonight, Stephen mentioned that, and what was suggested was to have a green strip along the side of it and to maintain it pretty much the same as what is above it as we go further toward town. And there is approximately, I think, a 6 foot, 5 foot to 6 foot sidewalk with a green buffer strip. And in fact, there is a curbing of type, and it's one of the berm type curbings made of blacktop. And I think what we'd have to do at that point is that whether we put the curbing in or not would be to look at the runoff and controls, and we would suggest that that would be the measure that we meet at the planning board's discretion as to whether they wanted us to put that curbing in or not, but that would be one thing we would check. But definitely it would be, in fact, like the one that was above, so that aesthetically, as you came down Scott Dyer Road, that it would meet. And then hopefully, with First Atlantic, something could be arranged to tie those two together to have a continued sidewalk right through.
And that's called Cape Cod-style curbing.
That's right.
That's probably a question that should be clear with Public Works.
That's what we do.
The town engineer, I would think,
before the November meeting.
Correct. I think there was a mention, too, and Steve already has taken steps of moving the parking lot closer to the building so that we did not affect the trees along the I think that would be the northeasterly sideline, and he's done that, and there seems to be no problems whatsoever in accomplishing that.
Mr. Chairman, perhaps the applicant can just clarify in terms of what parking lot,
yes.
So it's clear to everybody.
This parking lot right here. When we now we kept it a little further away from the building. It's not the impact on the building, but it impacted on a bunch of nice oaks in here. So we're all kind of under consensus of opinion. We decided the oaks would be better to stay so that people in the building can see those instead of having a green space in front of the building larger. So I split this parking lot over. And at the same time, when we walked around here, after rain now, I moved this fire lane over approximately, or almost 15 feet, so we get out of the grading problem that we were in, because it looked like we were filling almost over bushes. So it just came in closer to the building, because somebody brought up the trees over there. I think it would have to be kept out in the winter. So it's going to have to be kept plowed in the winter. So it's going to be open, and I just moved it up closer to the building to get away from any possible infringement on any of the shrubs that push along in.
We also, if it gets a building, we'll then add a planting touch by something like a planter, so that basically you could have a bumper, but basically also have planters in there, so it doesn't, you know, look unkept.
Mr. Chairman, I wanted to also point out to the planning board that I'm on the board of directors of the Land Trust. And there has been a transfer of land from an applicant before the planning board to the land trust, and there's always a potential for a conflict of interest when a person serves on more than one group in a community. Therefore, I think it's important that any discussion of the land trust and the acceptance of that land that I not participate in as a planning board member, so I'll be remarkably silent during those portions of any discussions about any transfers of land.
So noted. Any other questions from the planning board at this point? Tom.
I had several questions. I think you discussed at the workshop that you were not using a professional architect to design the building. Is that still correct?
We are using an architect now on the structural side. We're dealing with coastal structures, and we'll be using an architect for all of our structural design and to meet all state specifications.
Is that a registered architect or a registered structural engineer? A
registered architect.
Okay. One thing that I made a note to myself is that the building is extremely close to the stream on the westerly side of the building. First, let me premise everything. My children go to school at Pond Cove School and have enjoyed the tremendous community relationship that's offered through the Viking Nursing Home with the children going down. I congratulate you with your participation in the community, and I think it's a real benefit to the community. Having said that, I would also say in reviewing the plans, I think one of the things that we were asked to consider in site plan review is how it fits within the neighborhood or how it fits within the character of the town. And being a fairly large two-story addition, admittedly you meet all the height requirements, and with your variance you meet the setback requirements, but the building is very much a very plainly articulated building, very large in its mass and bulk, and attaches to the existing building in three places. From my personal standpoint, I feel as though it's going to have a significant visual impact on Scott Dyer Road, and I think given the fact that you're adjacent to existing residential houses, single-family houses, there may be another way in which to make that transition or to help me to understand how your building fits in with the existing residences. I guess I'm a little surprised that nobody showed up from across the street to question what the visual impact would be from that side of the street, but when I look at the building elevations, excuse me, I guess specifically the elevation that's adjacent to the stream, on the drawing that I have, the elevation has what I guess is a fairly large cut line in it. So I never get to see how big this building is as a building, and I'd like to understand that. And I'd also like to be able to see how it fits in to the context of the neighborhood. I think if the elevation were extended across the street and showed the relationship of the height of the building to the to the building across the street in one direction and to the residential building adjacent to it. I think that would be helpful for me in understanding the mass and scale of this building within its context. And I say this in reference to, I think, something that was distributed by you called Chain's Take on Retirement Housing. And on the front of it is a really delightful, assisted living facility that has front porches and very similar single-family or multifamily residential characteristics that, at least in my experience, most of the housing awards that have been given for state-of-the-art assisted living or community care facilities tend to have those treatments. And those treatments, I think, come from a combination of wanting to provide an exceptional living environment for the elderly, something that's a little less institutional, something that fits into the neighborhood character a little bit more positively. I think that comes from a close working relationship between the developer and the architect. And I guess since you supplied this to me, I would say I'm not asking you to design a facility like this. I'm just saying this is something that, in my best judgment, fits into more has more character similar to the residential scale that you're adjacent to. And I really say that only in context that you've been granted a variance to be close to the stream on the one hand. You're no closer to the road than you already are, but given the mass of the building, it's reasonably close to the road. And through your generosity, you've contributed a tremendous amount of open space to the community. But one of the ironies of cluster development is that the resultant visual impact of density is extremely high. To me, I'm very curious as to what the actual density on that building parcel that you have identified, essentially that filled area that incorporates the existing nursing home and the proposed addition. I don't know what that density is, but to me it's probably very high. And what I'm getting at is, in order to address the visual impacts of that high density, I think there's a little more that could be done in terms of architecture. And perhaps your landscape architect has done a commendable job providing a lot of buffer planning along the road. The question I would have is the right-hand parking lot as you're facing the building from Scott Dyer Road. That parking lot appears to be within about 10 feet of the existing building, and if I'm not mistaken, there are bedroom units there in the nursing home now, and that seems to me to be sort of a jarring impact that those people should either be provided a buffer from that parking or the parking should be removed perhaps a little bit further away. And I'm also wondering if there's a way in which you could angle the right-hand side of that right-hand parking lot slightly back toward the building to provide just a little more relief at the street, since it is quite close, at least on these 50-scale plans, appears to be quite close to the street. One other issue, particularly we have a fire chief, and you've coordinated with him, you provided access to the back of the building. But as I look at the westerly side of the building, well, let's discuss a little bit in case of a fire. Is it intended that everyone would be physically capable of getting into the fire stairs and exiting the building, or would the, in a worst-case situation, would the fire department have to use ladders to rescue people from these, both the lower and upper floors?
We don't have to use ladders, no.
You don't?
No. The state fire marshal's directives, as you well know as an architect, are very extreme when it comes to nursing home care and ambulatory patients. And we have to design this into our buildings to take care of those. We also have elevators we cannot use in a fire.
Right.
You've rattled off quite a few things, and I would like to not rebut, but maybe clarify some issues.
I have just one last issue, and that's regarding the enclosed courtyards. There was no issue of access to those in case of fire?
No.
None at all?
No.
Okay.
First of all, your issue on aesthetics. I think aesthetics, and I would use as an example a development that I just drove into this weekend called Falmouth, the golf course. And one of the things that we happen in New England to do is we happen to have a great diversity of attention into what one wants to live in and what one feels New England should be. And I think that if you walk into that type of development, you can see a colonial home, which might be Royal Berry Willows or anything that you would like. And then also you can find further on down a fairway a Frank Lloyd Wright design. And I'm sure that along the main coast, I fly an airplane and I notice this a lot, that we're seeing an awful lot of diversification of architecture. One of the things, and I have been very strong in my attitude toward architecture in the 20-some years of development, and we've developed projects in Falmouth and in Cape Elizabeth and in Kennebunk and York Harbor, and we've done Stage Neck and Point Arundel, and we've done Fletcher's Woods, and we've done many of these that have been colonial design. We've also done contemporary buildings. And one of the things that I've always found in the developments that I've had is that one of the worst things that can happen is to try to mix design while attempting to attach buildings. We have a contemporary design at the Viking, and it has sat on that site for 11 years, and we tend within reason to think it's attractive in a contemporary setting. It necessarily isn't colonial. It isn't what one would think of in a colonial New England town, but I don't think that half the stuff today that is being built necessarily is. I don't particularly care to see some of the designs that allow for different pitches on roofs, but that's my taste. Mm-hmm. The one thing I do feel, though, is, however, that I have to look at a neighborhood, and I have to look at the height restrictions, and I have to look at the complexity of design and the ability of attachment. And one of those things in the ability of attachment deals with the height of the building. And if you were to take a garrison, and you tend within reason to assemble in mind what I would agree to was a colonial architecture or a cottage-style community, cottage-style home, if you were to take a 28-foot wide garrison, which is a very sizable garrison in width, and you were to put a 10 pitch on it, which most people like mm-hmm. to do, and a lot of people put 12s, you're sticking that building up out of the ground, and if you landscape it correctly and you only put a foot of foundation showing, and most people want more than that because they're worried about everything else, that building stands out of the ground about 32 feet, 33 feet. The addition at the Viking stands out of the ground 33 feet. The addition at the Viking, because it's 46 feet wide and that the main building on the Viking is 56 feet wide, only stands 8 foot 3 inches higher than the Viking as it stands right now. So aesthetically, I would be very happy to draw some parallel lines. It would mean us going out with a transit and taking the degree of this height of the buildings across the street, but I think you'd find that the height of our building basically is lower and going to be lower than the one across the street, because the one across the street in fact sits in a higher elevation. But I'd be very happy to do that. When you talk about the cottage community, I agree, but if you would notice, and I've done a great deal of traveling looking at assisted facilities, and I would agree with you, there's in fact one that you're looking at is going to be built up in Waterville, but that's a freestanding building. And I would hate to think that I was going to take a contemporary design and stick a Royal Berry Wills addition onto it, because I think at that point, the aesthetic view, the eye would draw closer to the change of design and would further draw into what I would consider to be bad design. Needless to say, I think that if we were designing a town, you and I would probably design a town of all colonial homes with little white fences, and it'll be cute for New England. But very sadly, that isn't the case when it comes to the Viking in the design that was there, which we tend to think is pleasing. Talking of buffering, I would agree. There are two rooms at the end of that hallway, and the parking that we're talking about, all right, that parking in the front is visitor parking. And needless to say, at a nursing home, visiting hours usually are done by 8 o'clock in the evening, so that parking wouldn't be used at those hours that those people would be sleeping. I agree with your concerns, and in any way possible, would do anything we can to address any of your questions. We'll attempt to give you some scale rules on the height of the building surrounding. The abutting property, in fact, to the south is a property that we two or three different times attempted to purchase, and we attempted to purchase just exactly for that, to leave it as open space. Needless to say, we do not have control of our neighbors and what they do in subdivision. You people control that, we don't. But we do think that the buffer is allowed along that brook, which, by the way, when we were allowed a variance from the town, we ended up setting that building even much more over by redesign and getting it further away from the brook, I think by another 20 feet. But I'm sure that we, as people at the Viking, being here in 11 years and dealing with the neighbors, I think have got the confidence of our neighbors in the fact that we are not going to do something there to hurt them. And I think that when you say you're surprised that no one came, I think that basically as being a neighbor, I think that's the reason they didn't, because they realize that we do aesthetically care. And I would wish, if you would like, Tom, at any time, to offer anyone on the planning board to ride through any developments that I've developed, every one of them, in fact, which are no further than 35 miles from here, and get a better aesthetic view of what Ronnie Boutet does and how he builds and how he landscapes, so that you could get a better feeling of how I adapt buildings to a neighborhood to make you feel more comfortable.
Well, I don't know if we're, to me, whether it's colonial or something else is not the issue. It's the issue that it's in scale to the people who are going to use it, and it's, you know what I'm saying, and I understand what you're saying. And
the living interior, by the way, the last question you mentioned was the ease of access. In the circumstance of living facilities that are now created to be more home-based occupancy type. You will notice that in our new design, what we have done is we have opened up many more living areas, all right? And so I think we've got an average of one living area per 15 people, where in the Viking nursing home side, you do not have that. And one of the scopes, one of the reasons for this is that in neighborhood living, old people tend with the intention to migrate to smaller groups, not to larger rooms. And our whole attitude is to create a neighborhood concept, and in that neighborhood concept, to feed people in one area and then invite people down to come in and sit in and eat with them. So basically, even though the exterior is basically confined to an addition, which has to meet site requirements, setback requirements, but it also in the interior, it has many innovative ideas which will, within reason, bring that warm aesthetic pattern of life to the people that are going to be staying there.
Thank you.
Any other questions? We are getting along in time.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I had several. I guess I might as well address the visual impact issue myself. I mean, I remember in the first meeting you said you didn't like, I don't think you said you didn't like architects, but you didn't use them very often. My initial reaction was that I could tell that. I had asked at the last meeting, and I guess it was just misunderstood, that the front corners of the building, the poles were set at the height of the building, which that wasn't done. There was one post put up at the peak of the existing building to show the height of the peak of the roof. My concern was the impact of the structure. It's a two-story building, sits about 115 feet back from the road. The visual impact of that building. Tom was nice by calling it the plain looking. I think it's, that end of it is ugly. And I would urge you to engage an architect, design architect, to work on that. I think it has a great deal of impact on the visual impact on the neighborhood. I don't know all the fancy terms that deal with the architectural design and so forth. I just know that it doesn't look good. It looks like the end of a building, and it's the street side of the building. I'd say the side of the building that faces the stream is probably the nice, most attractive design that you have. Unfortunately, that doesn't face the neighborhood or face the street. What you have is the end, the ugly end of a building sticking out. And I think a great deal could be done to make that more attractive. I'd certainly urge you to give
Steve,
that consideration.
Let me say to you that, number one, the words architects, let me explain that I have nothing against architects because basically all my life I copy them. I mean, I love Roberry Wills and I love any person that designs colonial homes and tend within reason to attempt to design that way. I would agree with you on the end of the building, and we are in fact doing some work on that now, and we're thinking of creating a cut line by using a roof system, all right, to create a beltway. Mm-hmm. Now, and I say this in jest because I was the one that suggested they put the stick on the roof. And the reason I said it was this, and it was a simple. I have a good friend, and I was going to bring him in tonight, and I said it because I was trying to make a point. And the point was, if I have a man that's 6'8", he comes and he stands on the floor and he stands beside by himself, and people in the room are 5'2", 5'3", and they look at the person, they'll say, oh, my God, is he tall? And if I were to walk up to that person at 5'6", and I would stand beside him, they'd say, oh, my God, is he tall? But if I were to fill the room with people that were 6'4" and 6'5", and I would stand around, people would say, my God, they're all pretty much the same height. One of the things that I wanted to do was to establish what was the height of the building, and I apologize. I was trying to set an image of actual height of where it would be. But what we were trying to do was say, if I stuck a pole up, basically there's nothing to correspond that pole to what is there. And so what I was doing was attempting to show you the height of the building and the highest part of another building was there.
I understand that. That was explained to me, but that was not what I was looking for. And the problem being is that it still get no sense of the impact of a two-story building in that residential neighborhood.
I think what I can
see from the elevations what some sense of what that's going to look like. But I think if we don't really address that, that the neighbors in that area are going to say, oh, my goodness, when that two-story structure goes up, that's a big... It visually, it's going to be more than twice the size of what's there.
I can,
and that's going to have a great deal of impact on the neighborhood.
I can, in fact, and it's very easy to do because it's done in sketch form, that we are working on that end of the building to create a belt to make it. We did hit that end so that the actual roof line didn't have a tall gable, and we are working with the end of that building, and I think you'll be quite satisfied, and we'll be able to show you those sketches.
Okay. I'd like to move on just quickly on one other issue. We asked that you do a feasibility study. The author of the feasibility study wasn't identified, so I don't know who wrote the feasibility study. One of the reasons we're concerned or we're requested a feasibility study is we want to make sure that a project this size economically makes it or has a reasonable likelihood. Followed through the entire feasibility study, I have some questions, I guess, basically on the reverse mortgage. You're depending on 30% of the occupancy, not necessarily the 30% of the income, but 30% of the occupancy using the reverse mortgage type instrument to feed their income flow to get the $21,000 per year that is the starting average fee for per unit in your structure based on a $27,000 income. On page 15 of the feasibility study, it talks about the reverse mortgage, and it says that and I go into this because it's essential to the end, and you say that it's essential to this entire aspect, that you use a sample here of a house with a net worth, and then this equity in a house is worth $5,400 per year as extra disposable income. Can you give me some idea of how you came up with the $5,400?
One of the things before Kent goes into this very quickly, one of the problems that we do have, and we all recognize, number one, that we're getting into an environment, which I mentioned earlier, of less and less federal and state subsidies. Mm. The reverse mortgage plan hasn't been acceptable in the state of Maine because bankers haven't accepted it, but in fact it's a nationally used program in many cases to subsidize just exactly what we're talking about. But I think Kent can
explain.
My name's Kent Coffin. I'm the author of the study.
Who do you work for? Is it Ken?
Kent.
Kent?
Kentek is who I work for.
Okay.
Kent's my own private consulting firm. Okay. Basically what I did is I took some statistics put out by the state. It could have been the state planning office.
Yeah, I read through that. It's just the amount of $5,400 as extra disposable income is what I was interested in, how you came up with that figure.
What you're asking is a very technical question, and I wrote this back in 1989.
All right.
I'm trying to remember how that was. I took a reverse mortgage.
Let me just see if this rings true. You say that the house has a net worth of $60,000, 80% LTV, so you got a $40,000 loan, basically, a loan equity in the home. Here's a 9.6, and I guess back in 1989, 9.6 was a reasonable mortgage rate, over a 20-year period.
Right.
Because you bought a $450 per month.
That sounds right.
Typically a payment times 12, I think, is the $5,400.
Yeah.
If you or I had a mortgage payment of $450 per month, how much of that would be principal?
You'd have
payment?
To assume that.
In say, the first 3 to 5 years.
Oh, 90% of it or more.
Mm-hmm. No, I'm saying
principal. How much would be principal?
Yeah.
Not so much would be interest. Very little would be would be principal.
Are you aware in a reverse mortgage only the principal portion is forwarded to the payee, the person receiving the funds?
I wasn't aware of that.
You can alter that. You can make the payment to the payee larger, but the principal amount still accrues toward the equity of the home. Okay.
Ken, this is my side of it.
Okay, sure.
All right. First of all, what you mentioned, the reverse mortgage program that we've set up, and I've set up many of them, all right, can be set up in many different ways. And one of them is to set up, and in layman's terms, it's a line of credit, all right?
It's two different things.
So people understand it. It's almost like a home equity arrangement, all right? In the circumstance where you own your equity in your home, right? And the bank comes in and the bank says to you that your home is worth $100,000, and we'll lend you 80% loan to value. And they start a drawdowns attitude toward that amount. And then that drawdown, the first month, let's say that you set aside $400 a month, and in the first year, all right, you're going to use $4,800 of that drawdown amount.
But you don't get that. You only get the principal amount.
That's right.
That's right.
But you, when you say
but the entire amount, the $5,400 is taken away from the equity portion of the owner.
That's right, but it's not charged in interest.
Yes, it is.
Well,
I've checked all over the state. I'm a banker. I've checked all over the state, and that's how it works.
As I said to you, in the state of Maine, mm-hmm. right now,
that's where the project is.
But we are writing mortgages right now in the state of Maine through companies in California, companies in Texas. There are very few mortgages left in the state of Maine that you can buy. And, in fact, most of them are being sold. In fact, the only reverse mortgage program I know of in the state of Maine was one that was being discussed, and I haven't even found one in the state of Maine.
Misha has a program. Gorham Savings,
yeah,
Damascotta.
Misha, but it's a subsidized program through the mm-hmm. state of Maine.
But they all work on a reverse mortgage basis.
That's right. But the ones that we have written have been written on a reverse mortgage basis, whereby it was almost like a line of credit.
The two opposite instruments. So maybe it's just a matter of term. I talked to a number of bankers around the state, and I explained why I was asking them the question. They said, no, you can't use it for that.
Because
it doesn't work that way.
Because, number one, there is no bank in the state of Maine that I know of that has a reverse mortgage plan.
Yeah, several of them do.
Do they? Yeah. Subsidized, though.
Gorham Savings, I just talked to the gentleman there.
We don't have any in the Biddeford-Saco area, and I don't know of any in the Portland area. And those are the ones that we'd be going after.
They're very difficult instruments to work. That's all. And I don't want to belabor the point, but it is important that you're utilizing 30% of your occupancy based on people drawing from the equity in their home. It doesn't work that way.
I think the easiest way to say it, Steve, would be this: when we're talking about, we're only talking about one of the financing services of taking care of the elderly. All right.
Mm-hmm.
When we opened the Viking, we were running at about a 45% to 50% private patient load. And in that 45 to 50% private patient load, with none of these programs helpful, these people were maintaining and paying for those services. We know of right now probably 10 patients in the Viking nursing home that are in private patient care that are paying upwards of $125 without reverse mortgage plans,
mm-hmm.
that would be able to move over to the assisted side and be paying $75. I do not in any way argue how a person is going to be paying for their care. My point is that the need is there, and the feasibility study shows that. That, in fact, the need of that care, whether it be in home care, whether it be in daycare, or whether it be in assisted care, is something that we must face because 39%...
I realize that, but what you're saying is out of the 11,734 people that your market is, you're drawing from, a certain percentage have to have that income. You say that the 10.8% have this, but you depend on for another third of them to be able to have the income based on that. I'm just saying the last 2 years I've been looking at feasibility studies similar to this, and then that's the shortfall. Everybody's looking for the same dollar. We're asking you to provide that information that says that this is a reasonable assumption to make.
I think that within reason we're arguing the semantics of how you decide. You call a reverse mortgage program and you decide.
This reverse mortgage that you have in here will last about 8 3/4 years, not 20 years.
That's right. But if we have an 85-year-old person that's moving into our assisted care facility.
That's not your statistics are
right.
relating here.
I think what's come up here is a question on the finance and marketability. And we've had this question before on other institutions that have come before us. And I think Mr. Edsel is bringing up an extremely important point for the simple reason that we want you to be successful. We don't want this project to fail for lack of financial planning. And unfortunately, these days, we have to ask questions a little bit more than we did before. Maybe we should have before also. But I think there's some questions here in Mr. Essel's mind. I think there's some questions in other planning board members' minds. And if there's something that can be done prior to the November meeting to help clear this up,
yeah,
that would
be
helpful.
I think that, as I explained before, and we're going to be submitting that to you when Mr. Essel asked us of financial capability, all right, and one of the funds that we are working with is 232, which is an Essel.
Yeah, there's two different issues. One was feasibility, one was financial capability.
But the feasibility study that we put together was put together by Kentech, but it was also put by a graduate student that's going to UCLA that has done nothing but solid research in this. He spent a sabbatical all last summer with us in putting this thing together. And that was one of the programs through across the country that is used to supplement, all right, the needs of income. Now, one could say, well, we're going to get it from our kids, but you don't write that in a feasibility study. And I think that the reverse mortgage program that you're talking about, I would give you the information, I will give you the information of the types of programs that I'm talking about. I have my parents on one right now, and they don't work as you. Yep.
Let's look at the bottom line, which is the number of the captured penetration rate, I'm shown on page 30. With a 60-unit bed using 75 years of occupancy or older.
I can't hear you, I'm sorry.
Okay, with a on the bottom line, down under 75 plus,
mm-hmm.
It says, based upon the numbers that I figured, you just basically said there's a third more people, let's chunk the reverse mortgage concept out the window for a second. Even though that's not true, that's the worst case. Wouldn't you agree? If we throw the reverse mortgage out, we have 10.8% of
right.
the population left
right.
compared to...
Well, that's what you're saying. This 10.8% of the population has an income of $28,000 or more.
Right. I mean, let's just go with that for the moment. Let's just talk about that. There's a penetration rate with 90% occupancy, which is what all our figures are based upon, of 3.5%. If we were to subtract a third... Well, say we were to add 1.5% back into it. Say we were to add those people back in, that population back in, subtract that population that has the reverse mortgages.
From they're not a part of the market.
From the market.
Is what, no, let's not go to page 30. Go back to page whatever it is. That's not, if they're not financially capable, then
right,
they don't come
up.
Into the focus of this last page. Is that right?
That's correct. Yeah. That's what I'm saying. But that's going to change that bottom number. That's the number that's important. Then if that number is under 5%, the captured penetration rate, that's what...
No, the number at the top, the 11,734, changes. You
Wait.
Drop that by 30%. Actually, it's 29%.
Okay.
Now your numbers.
Mm-hmm. That number changes.
Then you change...
But all these numbers just change.
That's right.
They ripple down through.
Yep.
So, say if we drop that number, the 3.5% number will go up. Do you agree?
No.
It will go down. It should go up.
Let me make a suggestion, because I think what we're getting into is a debate that may take some time, and while I'd like to see it happen, we have other things on our agenda
okay.
tonight. We have other items we have to get to. I think there's a serious question here on the feasibility study, and I think if it would be helpful to summarize these questions, maybe, Steve, you can work to do that. But I think what we need to do is take a look at some worst-case scenarios, and one that Mr. Edsel is suggesting possibly is that this reverse mortgage population should be maybe removed from the feasibility study, and does it still work?
And that's what I'm attempting to show. I believe it will.
Okay. Well, if you can show that, then I think that should be one of the submittals we should get for our next meeting.
No problem.
I'd prefer that it not be done, though, here because of
okay.
the time that's going to be consumed in trying to figure that out. Is that all right with you, Mr. Edsel?
Okay.
Are there any other issues?
Yes. Mr. Chairman, I'm sorry for taking this out of order, but there are a couple of questions. There were several issues that were raised in the engineer's report, and I haven't heard any comments on that. My opinion is that those should be addressed prior to approval.
Mm-hmm.
And secondly, on the grading and drainage plan, there's a finished floor elevation, basement 12.5. Does that go back to a time when there was a basement, or is there indeed a basement?
There is indeed a basement.
And what is a basement, the full, take up the full footprint of the building?
Yes.
And what's the purpose of the basement?
The basement will be, at the beginning, part of it will be unfinished. It will be storage space, and there will be some administrative functions moved into the basement.
Because I don't see any natural daylighting in there at all. In fact, it's 8 feet below outside grade. And the other issue is that it's about a foot and a half below flood level. And I don't know if that's going to affect your flood your insurance, but perhaps for some uses that may be a concern. I'm just raising that. I don't know what the answer to it is.
Okay, you asked two questions, and you asked about the T.Y. Lynn letter.
Yes.
Do you want me to go through those and then go back to the basement?
Yeah, one of the issues there was a reference to the geometrics, I believe.
Those are being done.
Mm-hmm.
Every item on the T.Y. Lynn letter is being addressed.
Okay, and you'll resubmit those plans to us.
We will submit those items on October 2nd. However, there are some items that are on there. November 2nd. I'm sorry. I'm getting confused. There are some items that should not that have been submitted previously that T.Y. Lynn didn't get.
Okay.
And those items are to kind of move. And that's it. Even a number 7, even the drainage plans from the internal courtyard are being designed by an engineer.
Mm-hmm. Could you provide us with a plan of the basement that would show what your proposed use is down there?
Yes, we could.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Butler, could you just review these requirements that our town engineer has placed on this project to make sure that we have a complete list for submittal on November 2nd.
Okay, I'm going to look at two items. One is going to be the completeness memo, which tied in with the town engineer's memo. Okay. Number 3 deals with information regarding the construction drawings, whether or not the level of detailing is satisfactory at this point in time, or if that's something that would need to be required after planning board approval of the project. But at some point, the town engineer is going to want to look at that. And since you're getting close to the point when you might be considering approval, number 3 is something that sounds like it's being undertaken. At this point, make specific mention about typical sections about parking and paving situations. Excuse me. Item 4 deals with the lighting plan. Some information has been presented in terms of the types of lighting. The applicants are planning on using a system that would locate the lights within the existing trees, so it'd provide kind of a filtered effect. However, the intensity of that type of lighting and some of the more technical details hasn't been provided at this point in time. Having talked with the applicant's landscape architect, they're still working with the supplier of those types of lights, and we'll be providing more information on the lighting scheme. Going down on item 5, we do now have the letter from the Portland Water District,
as well as solid waste.
Okay, on item 6, on traffic impact analysis, town engineer feels that it's rather light and a more detailed analysis should be provided. The applicant this evening and over the phone to me has said that they have said that they would be engaging a traffic engineer to look at the impacts on Scott Dyer Road and other relevant roads, as well as looking at the site distance issue. I guess for the record, I'd like to just ask the applicants who that traffic engineer actually is.
1 second. Dufresne and Henry?
Dufresne.
Dufresne and Henry?
Okay.
Told you I didn't know how to pronounce it.
There you go. Okay. I'm going down second paragraph on item 6. It talks about the fire chief should review and comment on adequacy of fire flow and hydrant locations. He's commented on hydrant locations and as well as fire flow. So that one's been addressed. Stormwater impacts was provided to the applicant. It's something that wasn't to the town engineer, so that's all set on item 6. Item 7 talks about some detailing. Town engineer states that it's a bit of information that can be provided prior to the issuance of a building permit. The board may want to have that provided before in terms of drainage pipes that should perhaps be located underneath the building. And that might get to Mr. Emery's comment about wanting to know more about the subterranean situations, basement, things of that nature.
We'll have that in hand by Friday. It's been worked on since last week.
Okay. Not sure if the grading item has yet been addressed by the applicants on item number 8.
Well, on item number 8, I mean, you know, I've been grading slopes and parking lots in the state of Maine for some time, and I've usually used a 5% maximum grade on parking lots in the state of Maine, just as long as you're not opening up a car door downhill. And, you know, it's, hey, I'll be glad to do it 4%, but I mean, you know, it's kind of a realm that you work in from 1 to 5%, and anything over 5% has a varying degree of not working properly when you open car doors. But I'm sure Tom has knows that same realm of slopes, and, you know, it's really up in the air. I mean, anybody can call it. There is no certain set standard that you work with, but usually it's from that 0 to 5% range for parking lots in snow conditions.
It's an item that's been raised by a town engineer. The board can, you know, either sign off on it or have the applicants follow through. It deals with the fact that in the westerly parking lot, there seems to be roughly a 4% cross grade. And Bob Hunter is saying that that may be a bit much under winter conditions, and the applicant may want to temper it a bit. The applicant's landscape architect saying that it seems to be within the realm of what gets normally built in the state of Maine. So,
Steve, which parking lot was that? Wasn't that on the easterly side?
That was back. Yeah, it was basically the employee parking lot. It's the one back here.
It's not the one that would be used to pick up and discharge residents, though, right?
No.
Okay.
Okay. Then I might have missed. I was. Town engineer says westerly. I thought he meant westerly, which would be the visitor parking.
Oh, down here?
Other side.
This one here?
Yes. Yeah. Okay.
It might be good to get that clarified so you understand which one we're talking about here.
Okay. I'll check with the town engineer, but whether or not he meant, I mean, it would make more sense that he meant the one in the rear. But. On item 9, Bob Hunter suggests that a new manhole be constructed. I'm not sure if the applicants have addressed that issue yet or not.
Yeah, it's going to be addressed. We're putting in a new manhole, and the town was nice enough to locate the existing manhole out there that we couldn't find today, and they're raising a man cover out there right now on Scott Dyer Road.
Okay. Didn't notice that today.
Yes.
Okay. And last but not least, a very minor item talking about the hydrant should have a valve complete.
They all have to have the valve there.
That will be indicated on the plans.
Okay.
Okay. We have an understanding of what's lacking. It will be my preference at this point in time to move on we can, and there is a suggested motion related to this issue before you. There's no other burning points of discussion. I'd like to entertain that motion.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
I think it may be an item that incurs costs in the project, and that's a clarification on the grading plan as to whether there's a curb between the walkways and the parking areas. It doesn't seem to be any offset in the contour line, so I assume that you're not proposing any. Then are you proposing wheel stops or something to separate pedestrian from vehicular?
No, I'll tell you, I've in most of my projects, I have not used wheel stops. We've just painted the lines on the parking lots because in the winter it's better for snow removal. You can get the snow out. There's no banging of wheel stops, and they work fine. I've done them in
fairly high-cost developments, and everybody's happy with it, and I've done them in low-income developments, and everybody's happy with it. I'd prefer to stay away from wheel stops in the parking lots and the curbing just from the standpoint of snow removal, because I can push snow a lot easier that way.
I guess the issue I would raise is that, particularly with elderly care facilities, if there are older people around, is it provides at least some stopgap measure between an automobile that might be left to roll, and it also allows some margin so that people don't park so close to the sidewalk as to have the front end of the car overhang the sidewalk, and then people aren't able to use the sidewalk.
Like I said, Tom, I've done it before in many, many residences, and I'd be glad to take you out there and show you that.
I guess what I would do is defer it to the town engineer and to see if the town engineer has any comment. And the only other thing is that you show contours on the planting plan for berms out front. And if those are indeed to be constructed, could you also show those on the grading plan?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Once again, I would entertain a motion at this point in time.
Mr. Chairman, be it ordered, recommend the motion be it ordered that the request for site plan approval by the Jupiter 9 Trust for a proposed 60-bed addition to the existing Viking Intermediate Care Facility located at 126 Scott Dyer Road be tabled until the November 20th, 1990 Planning Board meeting.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second that.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Motion is tabled until the November meeting. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next item is Robert Millicent Monks, and I see Ms. McCaw is here. So I will remove you, Mr. Emery, from voting status, if that's okay, at this point in time. Welcome. Is there a representative of Robert and Millicent Monks here to give us a little discussion of this plan?
I'm Tom Riddle. I'm here representing Robert and Millicent Monks.
Welcome. Once again, we're running a little bit behind, and I think it's useful for a very short description of the project. If you can give us a quick overview, and then we will have a public hearing.
Okay. We are seeking a special wetlands permit for a site off from Bowery Beach Road along Great Pond. This is an outline of the site, the critical wetland zone, the wetland up on the edge of Great Pond, the proposed entryway. I've also brought Al Frick from Al Frick's Associates, Rich Light from Land Use Consultants, and Betsy Day from Norman Doe Associates to answer any questions you may have, additional questions about wetlands. We had a chance to do the site walk on Saturday, most of us, and I assume everybody's dried out.
I apologize for not being able to be there. I was contemplating looking at it tonight, but I didn't want to come here with an arrow in my head, so I figured I'd not do it.
That's right.
And seeing that I didn't have any bright orange clothing, I figured that was better not to go, so I didn't.
Can I answer any questions you may have now?
Okay, at this time, I would like to know if there are any questions from the public. This is a public hearing. It is open at this time. Are there any interested parties here that would like to speak to this application? I recognize no requests of that kind, so at this point I will close the public hearing and I will open it to questions from the board at this point in time, based on your site walk and any other issues that may have come before you on this plan. So you have a question, look on your face.
I was just wondering who's going to go first. I think a number of us want to clarify whether when you went back and looked at the plans and so forth, it seemed to be a fairly small detail to just slide the house back, the house at the corner of the house itself.
That's correct.
Comes back in. And
that's
no problem.
I certainly have no problem with that.
Any other questions?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Tisbett.
So that we're clear, and I had just stepped away for a moment, so I don't know if there was a presentation about that, but the setback of the house is shown now on the site plan so that it's beyond the wetland area or boundary?
That's correct.
Okay, so you've already moved it back on your plan?
No, I have not already moved it back on the plan. I'm sorry. As it shows right now, that basically the critical wetland buffer runs across across the front porch of the building, and I have no problem moving that the 10 feet back to put us out of the critical wetland buffer if it is an issue with the board.
So then that would be a condition, presumably, that we'd apply. The second question I had, and raised it at the last meeting.
Well, either a condition or the plans would be prepared in that fashion for by the time we need to have them.
Yeah, but if we were to vote this evening, it would be a condition.
Yeah, that's right.
We had talked about the need to define the pedestrian way crossing the land to other lands owned or controlled by the town. Or other conservation groups to assure that people who are traversing the property would be doing so appropriately. And when we did the site walk the other day, you showed us where you had proposed to do that. Does the current plan reflect that description of where that public easement pedestrian right-of-way would be?
The pedestrian easement runs down between the hedges and the house, runs up across and crosses the road at this point. I had it clearly marked the day we were out there, but unfortunately...
It rained.
It ran, and it goes down the existing wood road to the edge of the Sprague Corporation property.
Now, how do we assure as a planning board that then in 20 years is the pedestrian access way that's used?
The indication that I got out of the meeting and was that we are prepared to cut and mulch the trail on a short-term basis, and it was the feeling of the Sprague Corporation through the Conservation Committee that they would establish in some written form and surveyed form the 12-foot pedestrian easement across the Sprague Corporation property.
Okay, I guess the question that I would have then of the board, I had anticipated that there would be an easement drawn on the site plan that would come back to the board that would be a part of the approval process, and then it could be referenced at any time as a pedestrian easement, so that it becomes a formal part of the document. Lacking that on a formal site plan, and if this board votes to approve this project, we would need some condition that adequately describes that and adequately takes it to the future so that it can be done, more than the representation, which is good, that this would be done. We need something for 10, 20, 30, 50, 100 years from now so that there's some document that's identifiable and the researchers can go to rather than some outdated tape of the meeting.
Right.
So we'll need something there, I presume.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, if I might.
I think our planner is quickly drafting language right now.
at the last meeting, we had talked about the potential for pollutants getting into Great Pond from a septic system that was located within the wetland area. And it is a question that members of the Conservation Commission raised on our site walk. And it's an issue that tonight we ought to again explore and address to have the applicant indicate to us what their research has shown and for the board to be assured that there isn't the potential for pollutants reaching Great Pond by the location of that particular septic tank in that location, because it is within the wetland area. So I would ask for that type of presentation this evening.
Within the wetland buffer.
Right? Within the wetland buffer, yes.
Do we have a member of the team that can address the trace elements that could come from that?
We have several, yes.
The proposed disposal area.
Sir, could you just identify yourself?
Yes, excuse me. My name is Albert Frick. I'm a licensed site evaluator and soil scientist who worked on this project.
Thank you.
The proposed disposal area is 199 feet back from the edge of the edge of the Great Pond, at right here at the critical buffer edge. The we looked at conceptually moving the leach field back further, and the area in this zone, Lyman, it's a glacial till, shallow to bedrock, and then as we move it back further, the bedrock gets shallower, becomes a more marginal soil. This point selected was the area furthest back from the Great Pond with the greatest depth of soil coverage. It has some practical considerations, being the fact that the well would be located upslope from the proposed leach field to assure environmental sanitation from a water quality standpoint. Also speaking with the Cape Elizabeth standards for separated black waste and gray water systems, if one was to suggest putting the leach field further back on the shallower to bedrock soils, it would require two pumps, a pump for the gray water system and a pump for the black water system, which is a consideration from a practical standpoint. The state of Maine subsurface wastewater disposal rules requires a 100-foot setback from a disposal system to a perennial water body. Okay. When we're thinking about pollutants from a leach field to Great Pond, I think the three parameters that come to mind are nitrates, phosphates, and bacteria. The phosphates are going to be tied up quite readily by the soil. In an acidic environment, the soil has a great capacity to tie up the phosphates and usually is not a concern for pollution unless through runoff and erosion into the pond. Nitrates will be moving, but I think what we have to consider here is the density of the development. Nitrates is in an anion form. It's going to be flowing through the soil, and what we have to consider for environmental impact is the density, which is a very low density development for that size property, one single family dwelling. And then the other consideration is bacteria. And once a mat develops under the proposed disposal bed, most of the bacteria will be filtered out by the organic mat within a few inches. On a safety factor, usually 50 feet is considered a very adequate separation distance for travel, die-off of bacteria, and so forth. And this proposed separation distance is 200 feet. So based on the state of Maine parameters, regulations, and most of the state-of-the-art thoughts on disposal design, at 200 feet setback should be more than adequate to assure environmental sanitation for the pond. Betty, do you have anything to add on?
I do want to clarify two things. My name is Betsy Day. I'm with Normando Associates. And I
thank
did
you.
Excuse me?
Welcome.
Oh, thanks. And I did the wetland delineation on the project. I just wanted to clarify a few things about the wetland boundary in the buffer zone, and I'm sure you'll correct me if I'm wrong in my interpretation of any portions of the ordinance. But this right along here is the boundary for the critical wetland zone, which of course by vegetation is the area of obligate wetland plants. That continues along, this is an upland area here, an isolated upland area. The critical wetland edge continues along there, goes up this way, and there's also a little upland, a small upland right there. This is the boundary of the wetland protection zone. To my understanding, there's a 100-foot buffer from the critical wetland zone and no buffer on the wetland protection zone. Okay, So the development and the septic system is well outside that 100-foot buffer zone from the wetland. None of these facilities are proposed in the wetland or very close to the wetland for that matter. The one issue that I think you may have questions from, just listening to Mr. Frick's explanation, is probably the nitrate. As you can see here, the actual edge of the pond is also quite a distance. What's the scale on this? Okay, so we're looking at about 150 feet plus from the edge of the upland wetland edge of the critical wetland zone to the edge of the actual open water. One of the functions of wetlands is that they take up nutrients, bind up nutrients in the plants, thereby protecting open waters. If there were to be any nitrates that were to come down from that system, which again is going to be a pretty small amount due to the low density use of the property and the distance that those nitrate laden waters, and I shouldn't even say that, they're not going to be nitrate laden, but there will be some nitrate in those waters are coming from that area of the septic system. The uplands that they'll be flowing through and the wetlands will, in my mind, be adequate, very much adequate, to protect the quality of the water in Great Pond. Any other questions in that regard?
So the actual distance, Mr. Chairman, of the septic system from the Great Pond will be closer to 350 feet rather than 199.
That's what it looks like, yes. Mm-hmm.
We received HE 200 point forms. Is there any question?
All three pages.
All three pages. any comments on those?
I just have a question. Probably it will go to Mr. Frick. And I think when we took a look at the site, we're concerned about the precedent set. We're talking about Great Pond here, one of our nicest water bodies. And we have this enormous site, and yet we find the septic system right just inside the 250-foot buffer. When we were there, it seemed to look over to what would be the east side, reasonably, I think we're 1 or 2 feet off in elevation, into... is it Naskeag soils?
Naskeag.
And the Lyman Tunbridge. When we were there, it was indicated that there was a ledge at 18 inches or so. Looking at the form, the soils test that we have here, we have limiting factor mostly by groundwater, existing groundwater, anywhere from 13 to 20 inches in all the test pits where it's located now. Just a matter of information. What's the benefit of moving it instead of being over where there's 18 inches of soil on top of fractured bedrock or whatever bedrock? What's the advantage of moving it to where there's by our ordinance, the marginal soils? It seems, you know, we're moving into the 250 foot buffer. When we have a spot right beside it, the seam, even though it was ledge, but we still had 18 inches of soil.
Right. Currently, the standards, state of Maine standards for defining suitable soils for siting of a disposal system requires a minimum of 15 inches of soil above bedrock throughout the entire disposal area. And as we move away, the bedrock becomes thinner. In the area that we were, it was going from greater than 5 feet to approximately 2 feet to bedrock on one corner. And then the limiting factor is the observation of a groundwater table on top of that bedrock. As we move away from the Great Pond, the bedrock becomes shallower to points where it's no longer deemed to be suitable by the State of Maine Plumbing Code. You need at least 15 inches to begin siting a disposal system there, and then from there you have to maintain a 2 foot separation to the bedrock. So anything less than 2 feet is not a suitable site.
So it's two different effects. Both, number one, limiting factor by groundwater, water table, and then the state guideline of the 2 foot to bedrock.
That's correct.
Okay.
12 inches, we need to maintain a 12 inch separation from the bottom of the disposal system to any indication of a perch water table.
This system, as it's drawn, seems to be built right on top of the existing grade, correct? It's a little difficult because you have a different scale vertically than you do horizontally.
Yes. There's going to be, on the uphill side on page 3, shows there'll be 30 to 33 inches of fill on the uphill side, and on the downhill side, approximately 4 feet of fill will be required. So we're creating a soil media there to assure proper filtration. Okay. Coupled with the design, it's a chamber system as required in the town of Cape Elizabeth. And along with that, we're providing 6 inches of stone underneath the chamber design to just add another layer of conservatism to the design.
Any other questions related to this application?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, Mr. Emery.
At the site walk, there were members of the Conservation Commission with us. Are any of those members here tonight?
None so indicated.
You had discussed that there would be some limbing of trees to enhance views to the pond and to clear up the dead debris.
That's correct.
Could you tell us to what extent that's proposed and how close to the edge of the pond?
I think anything that was close enough to the edge of the pond, it proved to be a safety hazard. We would definitely be limbing the tree up to, first we would take dead and dying tissue off from the tree. The next thing we would do is try to open up, raise the branch level on the larger trees to enhance the view out across the pond. There would be very little actual removal of any trees, and I tend to doubt we would do much of that in the critical wetland itself.
Steve, are there any standards within the buffer or within the 250-foot setback in terms of percent of trees that can be removed or understory that can be removed, similar to a state standard?
There is, depending upon what definition comes under. There's timber harvesting and then forest management activities. Again,
mm-hmm. No.
A fair amount can be done, yeah. But I think there are limits that would be imposed beyond a certain level. I mean, right now we're talking primarily about a residential structure with some accessory activities, and if it's something went over, started to get close to the timber harvesting standard, they'd have to come back for the planning board.
Okay. I don't mean to speak for the Conservation Commission, but I heard that raised, and I just thought I'd bring it up.
Mm-hmm.
I want to be clear to the public that this is not a site plan review. Isn't that correct, Steve? This is simply a wetland application.
Mm-hmm.
I guess more for my information, since I missed the last meeting, and perhaps there may be some other people in the room that are curious, and I apologize for not recognizing this situation sooner and bringing it up earlier, but is there any issue of a public access waiver requirement here, Steve?
There isn't in this case because the turns out the applicant's lot has quite a bit of frontage on Bowery Beach Road. It extends down and along for hundreds of feet where there's a lot of trees that are planted. I think there's a tree nursery. And so the lot itself has adequate frontage on a public road. The way the existing public access waiver standards are set up in the town's ordinances now, you don't have to have the frontage at the point where you're going to actually be exiting or entering the site. So.
And therefore, there's no maximum length of roadway or driveway.
Okay. Need a driveway.
Thank you.
Yeah. Mr. Wadman is here from the Conservation Commission. Does the commission have anything to comment on related to this application?
I was not able to attend the site walk, although I think several of my people were there, my people. I had a certain concern connected more with the activities of the Land Trust or the Conservation Commission and the siting of the property, in that perhaps it might be staked, as perhaps it was, I don't know, to see what the sight lines looked like from the land that's been recently acquired by the Land Trust. It seemed to the Conservation Commission, to the members of the Land Trust as well, it was too bad that we had mounted a huge effort in the community to acquire 4.5 acres of land for public access, only to find a house sited in close proximity. I don't know that that was done when you were there, if you were able to determine what the sight lines were from where the proposed house was toward the recent Jordan acquisition or not. Our concerns were naturally those of conservation of the land that is now the property of the town of Cape Elizabeth and the Land Trust.
I don't know. Steve, do you know if that question's been raised or resolved? The question of the land that the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust now owns and its sight line to this property is being developed.
I know it was discussed on the site walk, and that's something that I know the Sprague Corporation wants to talk to the Conservation Commission about in terms of determining the entire, you know, setting and making clear the actual extent and location of the pedestrian trails that would extend, in essence, from Fenway Road all the way out to Route 77. Is there more specific question? Or
I guess the question really is, will this property have a view of the town land, town-owned land, and vice versa? That's really the question, isn't it?
Yeah, right. Whether or not where the house is sited is going to look across the Jordan acquisition or and vice versa.
From my recollection at the site walk, it won't. Between the trees and the actual location of the Land Trust property, there's sufficient distance and also tree coverage, so it won't be visible.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Any other questions of this applicant?
Mr. Chairman, just a quick one. During the site walk, it was indicated that we would have this evening the agreement to use a private driveway. And I haven't seen that. Is that something that's going to be presented, or is that to be a condition of our action?
We have come to agreement in terms as far as Dave Pickering and the Sprague Corporation is concerned. I would like to have that as a contingent on tonight's vote, if we could.
Okay, so that'll be a condition then?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Any other questions? If not, we have prepared by our planner some language related to a vote on this wetlands protection special permit. And my suggestion is you take a look at those, that wording is on page 1 and 2 of our suggested motions, with the understanding that we'll be adding some conditions, if I understand correctly, to that. And maybe, Mr. Butler, you could add a section, I guess, C.
Mr. Chairman, I think I'm ready to make a motion. Do you want the whole thing read? I mean, it takes a whole page.
It's actually 2 pages long.
Well, one
can we
page.
Deal with the essence of it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. What is critical to be read into the...
Yes. Probably makes sense to read the whole thing. I don't mind reading it and then the board then commenting on it. But I think for the record, it probably does make sense procedurally to read the whole thing in. Hate to say it.
Well, I don't mind reading it, but I just don't want to take everybody's time.
Sounds like procedurally we have to.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we order that the planning board makes the following findings of fact and decision regarding the request of Robert and Millicent Monks for a wetland protection special permit for the placement of a single-family residence and construction of a driveway and subsurface disposal system on a lot located off Bowery Beach Road, map R6, lot 29, findings of fact. A. The applicants wish to place an existing house on their lot off Bowery Beach Road, map R6, lot 29, and construct a driveway and subsurface disposal system to serve this one single-family residence. B. Some of this proposed construction activity will occur within land that is under the jurisdiction of the wetland protection provisions of the Cape Elizabeth Zoning Ordinance,
specifically the subsurface disposal system and a portion of the residence is proposed to be located within the outer 150 feet of the wetland buffer, and a small section of the driveway will be situated within a wetlands protection zone. C. These proposed activities may be permitted with a special permit from the planning board if the planning board finds that the applicants meet the standards contained in section 19.3.9.04 of the zoning ordinance. And D. The proposed construction activities will not have any adverse impacts on the town's wetlands and meet the relevant review standards contained in section 19.3.9.04 of the zoning ordinance. Decision. Be it therefore ordered that the request of Robert and Millicent Monks for a wetlands protection special permit for placement of a single-family residence and construction of a driveway and subsurface disposal system on a lot located off Bowery Beach Road, map R6, lot 29, be granted in accordance with section 19.3.9 of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented, subject to the following conditions. A. The signed agreement between the applicants and David Pickering for adequate vehicular access to the site shall be submitted for review and approval by the town planner and the town attorney prior to the issuance of a building permit. B. That the existing pedestrian easements on the applicant's property shall be preserved, and the method for a clear delineation of these easements shall be negotiated between the applicants and the Town Conservation Commission prior to the issuance of a building permit. And C, that this special permit is being granted only for one single family residence, a subsurface disposal system to serve only this residence, and a driveway to service only one single family residence. And D, that the residence proposed for the site be set back an additional distance so that no part of said structure will be within the wetland buffer area.
Yeah, Mr. Butler, did you have some further changes to that, or was that?
That would. It's been covered.
It's been covered. Okay.
I have just a comment?
Yes. Well, we've got a motion made. Could I get a second before we have discussion?
Seconded.
Second. Okay. Now it's open for discussion.
Okay. With regard to the moving the building back 10 feet, I'm not sure that if we just didn't remove it out of the findings of fact, so it read specifically the subsurface disposal system would be located within the outer 150 feet of the wetland buffer, that would automatically presume that the building was also outside, that we wouldn't need to have, we could eliminate D. D under conditions.
I tried to change that as I came on it.
Okay.
And read that. I agree it could be removed from that, yet the site plan still shows the house to be located in the buffer
then
zone.
Perhaps show it, having them a new site plan or amend it. I don't know what's the reason.
Yeah, that would be one way to do it. And that was a question, Judith, that I raised earlier. Without lacking a site plan that shows the house outside the buffer area, we would have to have a condition that says we're changing their site plan that they've submitted to us. So I think it still would be required. And I stumbled over that language as I read it, as you probably noticed.
Yeah. It was very smooth.
Was reading.
Any further discussion on this motion?
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
Would it make sense then to perhaps consider another condition that would state that once that all the conditions and other activities that are included in the conditions, once they're done, that a new site plan be prepared and submitted to the town for their files?
What do we do with site plans? We don't sign them.
We keep them. Town planner keeps a copy. There's an official file copy.
Mr. Chairman, I think that would be a good idea. For one thing, it would show where this pedestrian easement is, and if anyone wanted to locate it after it's negotiated with the Conservation Commission,
yeah.
It can be done.
So basically we're saying that these conditions should be reflected on the site plan that's finally submitted.
A revised site plan.
Can you suggest a language? That's D? Would that be D?
That would be E.
E. So the condition E would be what under decision?
That a final, a new condition E would read something to the effect that a revised site plan shall be submitted reflecting the conditions of the planning board prior to the issuance of a certificate of occupancy.
Sounds good. Is that acceptable to the second?
Yes, second.
Okay. Any other questions or comments or discussion on this motion?
Just a question.
Wouldn't
the applicant otherwise be required in order to get a building permit to meet condition D have to submit a revised site plan?
That's the question.
I think what you've done is fine. I'm not trying to change it. I'm just curious as to how the code enforcement system works in this case.
Well, most cases, that's what the code enforcement officer would be looking at. I think it makes sense to make sure that's clear so that down the road, not in this case, but in other cases, that there wouldn't be any confusion, that it would take more than a phone call saying, yes, we're going to move the house back. And I think the applicants are aware of that. I think it just makes sense that it be made clear so that everybody knows there needs to be a site plan that the code enforcement officer can then use to go out on the site and actually inspect and see what's happening.
And won't the pedestrian easement become part of the deed and be recorded at the registry?
Doesn't show that it would be necessarily from this. Just simply says it'll be agreed with the town before issuance of a building permit. I think
I think what Tom is saying is that there would be an encumbrance on the deed that would be negotiated with the town. Probably would be at some point as an encumbrance, whether it's an amendment to the deed or however that's treated. Judith knows a lot more about that than
this most is of us. A place where indeed it should be in the deed.
Indeed, it should be in a deed.
I'm sorry. But this should be a place where, as you did the title, or it would become part of the record that this parcel of land was burdened and would be forever burdened, which is what we want to have happen by the easement. And it could even be stated perhaps as a condition. Oh, here, I'm taking my words back, that at any time that this is sold, or any deed goes, that would be in the deed, that it's subject to the rights of the town of Cape Elizabeth.
Right. It already presently is part of the deed to the land. I think the only thing that needs to be clarified is the exact placement of the pedestrian easement. There is a clear title to the town of Cape Elizabeth, as far as I'm aware of it. The pedestrian easement.
Do you have any problem recording the site plan?
No.
Because once that's in the registry with it clearly delineated as to where the pedestrian easement is, you're
both people are protected
fine.
At that point.
And I think that that might
I agree.
Be the easiest way for everyone.
Mr. Wadman, you had a question.
Normally, when there is the transfer of a right or interest, there is an instrument that goes into the town through the Conservation Commission. That's what we have more or less formally.
Does this mean that, again, I don't want to muddle the issue, but there was some discussion on site that you were going to do a meets and bounds, maybe stake the center line of it or something? I want to separate the confusion about delineation for people who are on site who want to use it versus where it can be legally located.
Right. I think our intention is that we want as much as the town wants to have this cleared up. I think it's been a little bit loose for a long time. I think the indication I was getting from both the Spread Corporation as far as the Mugs are concerned is that we want this bound, mm-hmm. and I think the town wants it bound. I think that we all have the same goal. I have no problem with pinning it and surveying it, and if it needs to be put in the deed, then we can do that.
Is that what Condition B says?
Mr. Chairman, I would like to propose a modification to B, which after the Town Conservation Commission would read, shall be negotiated between the applicants and the Town Conservation Commission, recorded in the registry, and appropriately laid out on the site.
So prior to the issuance of the building permit.
degradation should occur prior to the issuance of the building permit. I think the site can be laid out afterwards.
Is that acceptable to the maker of the motion?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, it is, as long as we separate the negotiate between the applicants and the Town Conservation Commission, and the rest of that was then recorded in the registry of deeds prior to the issuance of the building permit. As far as it being laid out on the site, that one I would expect would be a before a certificate of occupancy is given. Typically, building the house and be laying out the site before the path.
Okay.
So I'd read and then laid out on the site prior to the issuance of an occupancy permit.
Mm-hmm. What about to the second? Acceptable to the second?
Yes, I was just trying to, I'm just writing some language, if you wanted me to try to do that.
Could we repeat condition B, maybe just again?
A minute.
Would you speak?
Okay, I'll try. The existing pedestrian easements on the applicant's property shall be preserved, and the method for the clear delineation of these easements shall be negotiated between the applicants and the town's conservation commission and then recorded in the registry prior to the issuance of the building permit and then laid out on the site prior to the issuance of an occupancy permit.
Okay.
Fine.
Okay. Any other discussion on this motion? All those in favor, signify by raising your hand. Opposed? Passes unanimously. Thank you. You should receive a copy of these findings of facts and these conditions so you can work with them.
Great. Thank you.
Our next item on our agenda is a zoning ordinance change, subdivision ordinance change due to application completeness. And going back over the history of this issue, it was suggested by one of our retiring board members that we spend a lot of time on this issue of completeness, that it was to a great extent a waste of time, and that it could be accomplished by the planner alone. We've modified that somewhat by indicating that it could be accomplished by the planner in conjunction with the planning board chairman and or vice chairman, chairperson, or and or vice chairperson, excuse me. We've had this change reviewed by legal, by our town attorney. He's made some comments, and I think he's written a letter which lays out some of the precedents in court cases that reflect on whether an application was under review, deemed complete, or in any of those other stages, which can get the town into trouble. So it's not something that we can do lightly. I think it's an important move to make in terms of freeing up our docket and getting us into a position where when we do get into some real busy times, we're really looking at applications and not looking at the predecessor conditions. But we have to be careful when this language is drafted that we also don't get the town into trouble down the road by inadvertently having a staff person give the developer the impression that review has started, which it will not have started until the planning board takes it up. So, Steve, do you have anything more to add to this question of legal review?
I really don't. The board's gotten a number of different memos on this since we talked about it last time. Got the letter of October 5th from the town attorney. You got a memo then dated October 11th that attempts to incorporate the town attorney's comments into a revised draft, a draft number 2. And then this evening, you got a marked a photocopy of a fax with Michael Hill's comments dated October 15th that just indicates some areas where some minor changes should be made to the new proposed language. So that's kind of the order of events in terms of items, and I'd be willing to answer any questions that people might have.
Mr. Chairman, one yes. question. Are we required to have a public hearing on this before we send it to the council?
I double-checked. All of a sudden that hit me. The way the zoning ordinance is set up, well, first off, for a subdivision ordinance change, the planning board is not required to have a public hearing. Town council is. For a zoning ordinance change, a public hearing is required in all cases except when it originates from the planning board, in which case one isn't. It's at your option to have a public hearing on one or both, but if you care to, you could send it directly. You could recommend this be adopted by the town council and send it directly to them at this evening's meeting.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, second question. Are the various documents that we have, and we have a lot of documents on this, clear enough for presentation to the town council in their form presently with the facts that we got particularly?
Mr. Chairman, I might propose after this, I may even be in the suggested motion, that if it's not clear that the town planner, meaning that I would do the final revision with the town attorney's comments and send that off in letter form to the town council so they could then have it in its revised form without bolding, just with the underlines.
Yeah, I think it would be the preference of, at least I know it's my preference, to have the town council be considering the final version of what we're looking at here, not a bunch of amendments. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Any other questions on the reason for this or the administration of it? As you can see, there is planning board involvement in this question. It's not strictly a staff decision as to whether an application is complete or not. It also goes along with the administration that occurs right now, in a sense. If I'm the chairperson, I will sit down with the planner and review the agenda for the upcoming month, so it would be very logical at that time to also review application completeness issues. So it fits in a number of ways the way the planning board currently operates. So this is not that far out. Yeah. Judy.
Mr. Chairman, I have a couple of questions and comments on here. Mm-hmm. If I could just run through.
Sure.
Page 2 under item 4, I would recommend that the language questioned by the town attorney.
Are you referring to the September 14th?
Excuse me, the October 11th memo from Steve Butler to the board, that the language, he questions whether it should be may or shall under item 4, that should read may, in keeping with other proposed changes. On page 4 of that same memo, under, I guess it's both items 1 and 2 under C, revisions to the site plan review section. On a previous memo sent to Steve Butler, September 14th, from Michael Hill, there is proposed language that inserts this number 2 earlier before it gives the board the ability to require information. And I wondered why that was changed. It seems to flow more easily saying once the application is preliminarily determined to be complete, the town planner shall schedule the application. And then you might say then the planning board may require additional information. I don't know if the board is looking at the language I'm looking at. It just seems to read easier. Mm-hmm. I was just curious why that was changed. Steve might have an answer for that. Mm-hmm. Then two, a minor thing is throughout all these proposed sections, there's references to a 4-month period and a 120-day period. I wonder if there's no reason why we couldn't have it the same one way or the other. The final is just a question. Under the subdivision sections, the planning board issues a receipt to the applicant when they first come before the board. Under the site plan ordinance, the planner does that, and I wondered if there was a history for that. I just don't know. That was it.
Steve, do you have all those questions? Maybe you can start on one at a time.
I've got some. There's no history in terms of who issues the receipt, the idea being under site plan, the process isn't quite as delineated by state law as it is under subdivision. If the board wants to issue the receipt, that's fine. The idea was that I was trying as much as possible to take that burden, take all the paperwork off the planning board, but again, it is somewhat inconsistent, so whatever works. 20 days versus 4 months, I agree. Take your pick. I guess I would like to go with, I would recommend 4 months, as long as everybody understands that it's, you're dealing from regular planning board meeting to regular planning board meeting. The item coming up, dealing with the time.